People struggle with doubt, people struggle with change, people struggle with so many things. Why? Don't we say that Jesus has the power? Don't we say that I can do all things in Christ who strengthens me? Do we really believe that? If we believe, why it doesn't happen? Why do we try to do it in our power? Why don't we see change? Why do we have a religion of doctrines without power? Doctrines are good, don't get me wrong. But if you don't have the God of the doctrines, doctrines will never change anybody. What is the power? Tell me, what are the people resurrected? What are the sick healed? What are the people baptized by thousands? What are the people transformed? What is the power? How? This is what we don't understand. It's the most simple thing. It is so simple that people don't get it. And we will always struggle before we get this truth. We will never have power before we surrender. You basically can do evangelism, you can go to church, you can pray in the morning, you can read your Bible, you can pay tithe, you can go to camp meeting, sing in the choir, but that's not going to save you. And you can eat tofu, still is not going to save you. Yes. Am I saying that it's wrong to eat healthy? No. But you know, you can go to prayer and pray. Just do your duty. Pray the routine prayer. Without praying with all your heart and presenting to God in the most honest way your struggles. If I told my wife every day the same thing, I would sleep on the couch. Basically, ow. The power came back, huh? Let's turn this off.
Far away.
Still use it?
We will open.
Okay. Stop talking. I do the talking. So you can literally pray, and if you follow yourself, you pray the same prayer every day. And time you study, and if you catch yourself, you can read. You just read. Did it ever happen to study and you finished reading three chapters from the Bible and you don't remember what you read? And you just go through it and you have no clue? Hey, stop talking there. Tell her to stop talking. No talking. It's something very strange. When I went to Cuba, really wonderful people, kind and friendly, but everybody was talking like at the market. Almost the same here. We will never have success. If you pray and there is no power, or you pray to do your duty, stop praying. If you go to church and you don't find Christ there, stop going to church. It's not going to save you. If you study the Bible and you don't find Christ in the Bible, stop studying the Bible. It's not going to change. Only when you fully surrender, when you find Christ and fully surrender, that's going to save you and save others, and it's going to give you power. And how do you surrender? How do you surrender? Let me give you a story. We say we surrender, but we don't surrender. You know why we don't surrender? Why don't we surrender? Because we don't trust God. We say we trust God, but we doubt. We don't feel good before we do it. We don't feel good to fully release, give it to Him, and trust that He will work. And the Bible says that you need to throw all, to cast all your troubles upon Him. You need to cast all your struggles upon Him. You know what that means, to cast everything upon Him? The word there in Greek means to throw it far that you cannot touch it, reach it, or take it back.
So when you cast your troubles, your struggles upon God, you need to give it to Him and leave it there, and you trust that God has the power, has the wisdom, has the love to deal with it, and you don't need to go back to that problem. You don't have that problem anymore. You can move on. After we pray and present the problem, we still struggle with it. That means that we talk about it, but we don't give it to God. Do you understand what I say? Do you follow me? Why don't we give it to God? Because we don't trust Him. We say we trust Him, but we really don't. We doubt. Let me give you an example. When I was in Andrews, I was poor. I am poor now, but not. I have food, I have a nice house, I have a nice car, but I am not rich. But when I was in Andrews, I didn't have food. Basically, I did not have food. I had 2, 3, 4 days going without any food. And I had days that I would go to the corner because an old man would come with old cans of green beans. And he would give it to the poor for free. And I would get cans that were expired and open them and be happy. I ate today. I was broke. I had no furniture. I slept on the floor because I didn't have a bed. I had no insurance. I had no car. I would walk to the school as the apostles walked. You know, the apostles had a Honda Accord. You know why? They were all in one accord. You didn't get it. Okay. They did get it. Okay. And so I was broke. I was poor. By God's grace, my wife got 2 jobs, and I got 2 jobs. And we finally got a car. I went to the auction. You know what auction is? When people bid, I give 50, I give 60, I give 70. And I got a van, a Dodge Grand Caravan. I was stupid. You know why I purchased the van? Because it had TV inside. In 1999, to have a car with TV, now many cars have TV inside, but in 1999, the cars didn't have TV. And my car had a big screen TV and video games. And but it was cheap. That car should have been $10,000. I got it for $3,000. And I didn't think, why is it so cheap? Something should be wrong with the car. Why do they sell it so cheap? I said, wow, $3,000, and it has a TV. When you buy a car, you need the car to run, not to have a TV. But anyway, inside it had video games and lights and wood, luxury car. I got the car, and I went to school driving. When I stopped in front of the seminary, I opened the door, got off the car, and didn't close the door. Left it open so the classmates could see inside the TV. And everybody would look, and I would like, you know? I was proud and stupid. Well, I drove the car for 2 months, and guess what? The transmission broke. That's the reason they sold it cheap, because the transmission was bad. Man, a new transmission would be $3,000, and to install it, another $2,000, that would be $5,000. And I didn't have a penny. So, I started to pray. Lord, help the transmission function. What do you think happened? Nothing. And I prayed more, because if we pray, God is going to answer. And I prayed more, nothing happened. And I had faith, nothing happens. You know, we use faith to manipulate God to do what we want. Faith is not that if you believe, God is forced to do what you want. Faith is not for God to do what you want. It's for you to trust that He does what He wants, and you trust Him even if you don't understand. Do you understand? Faith is not for you to manipulate God. It's for God to manipulate you. And you trust in Him though you don't understand. That's when you have faith. I said, Lord, I believe that you would fix my car. I need to not change gears. It was stuck in the second gear. And I said, I had faith. And God didn't answer my prayer, as faith would force God to answer. And then I fasted. We use fasting like hunger strike to force God to do what we want. Fasting is not that God has no options but to answer your prayer. Fasting is that it clears your mind to understand God's will. And I fasted and it didn't work. And I prayed even more. And I put the car for sale. Nobody called. It's like everybody knew that Dodge has a bad transmission. And so I went to the junkyard and purchased from a bad car that was involved in an accident, I purchased a second-hand transmission. I paid $500 for transmission and another $450 for labor. A church member that was mechanic, I paid him $450 to install the transmission. Almost $1,000, and I had no money. Basically, I took the money for 2 months and fixed the car and had no food and no money for the apartment for 2 months. Fixed the car, put it for sale. I put a paper in the window, luxury car that has TV. Good price. Nobody called. I put it in front of the mall, in front of the Walmart, on Craigslist, on eBay, Amazon. Nobody called. I prayed. Nobody called. It's like everybody knew that Dodge has a bad transmission. And so I had, man, I have to drive the car. I need something to go to church. I need something to go to do the visiting. So I need to drive the car. I got in the car and it broke again. The transmission stopped working again. I was driving with my wife and my kids to Washington City, the capital, Washington, D.C. And on my way back, the transmission broke. It got stuck in the second gear. I was driving 20 miles per hour. 20 miles per hour. Really, like 30 kilometers per hour. Really slow. On the interstate, everybody was blowing the horn, showing me fingers, you know. I said, come on, it doesn't work. Oh, I got off the van. I got so angry. I started to kick the wheel. My wife, honey, calm down. You are a pastor. You need to be calm. I went back to the junkyard. I purchased another transmission, secondhand, $500. I paid again $450 to the same church member. Second time, spent another $2,000, another $1,000, altogether $2,000, fixed the car. I got tired of that car. I hated the car. Did it ever happen to you to hate something? I hated that car with all my heart. And could not sell it. And I prayed for 6 months and God didn't answer my prayer. So I said, hey, I have to drive it because I have no car. So I drove to my church and had a prayer seminar. And in that prayer seminar, I told them, you are not a Christian, even if you keep Sabbath. Pharisees kept Sabbath and they killed Jesus. Even if you eat clean, even if you go to church, Pharisees went to church more than you do. You are not a Christian before you fully surrender, because Jesus said, who doesn't hate mother and father, you remember? He didn't say mother-in-law. That would have been easy. But he says, who doesn't hate brother and sister and job and self is not worthy to be my disciple. You remember? And Jesus said, whoever tries to save his life will lose it. whoever gives up his life for me will save it. If you want to have bread, you need to throw away to give your bread, and it's going to come back to you. And basically, Jesus says, whatever you surrender, that's what you get. And whatever you save and keep, that's what you lose. It's going to be cursed. If you really want to be blessed, you need to surrender. Jesus says, you cannot be alive before you die. The seed, the corn, it needs to die. The grain needs to die. And when it dies, then it produces fruit. And Jesus says, if you don't die, if you don't surrender, you will never be a Christian. You will never get victory. You can struggle forever. You'll never have patience. You'll never overcome sin. The more you try, the more you sin. You'll never get victory before you learn to fully surrender. And let me tell you this. God is not asking you to give up only the bad stuff. God is asking you to give up the good stuff too. Hello? What I said? You need to give up your righteousness. You need to give up all the good stuff. Give up your school. Give up your job. Give up your car. Give up your family. Give up everything. Give up trying to be good. Give up trying to be forgiven. Give up trying to be saved. Give up heaven.
Paul says, I would rather be anathema. Greek means cut off from the book of life. I would rather be anathema, but let them be saved. What is that? It's giving up heaven, am I right? You need to give up self to the point that you don't give up only the bad stuff. You give up everything and you say, Lord, here it is, the bad and the good, myself, my life, my salvation, do whatever you want. If you want me to live, I live. I live for you. If you want me to die, I die. I die for you. I am yours, me, my family, my school, my life, my health. Do whatever. I trust you. Why don't we give up? Why do we try to get forgiveness, to get salvation, to get victory? Why? Why don't you give up? As long as you try, you will never get it. Before you learn to surrender, only He can give it to you, and He is not gonna work before you learn to surrender. Like Jacob. Jacob was a good Adventist. He ate healthy. He didn't eat pork. Okay? He kept Sabbath. He returned tithe. Yet, oh, he had a dream with a ladder and angels going up and down. Yet, all his life, he tried to accomplish things in his power. All his life, he tried to accomplish things in his power. And when he was sick, if you know that, he was sick.
Okay. Before we finish, we have experienced 20 mics. Jacob tried to solve things in his way. I'm going to put a skin and say, I am Esau, and get the birthright. I'm going to put this in the water so the sheep and the lambs will be this color. I'm going to do this. He solved his own problems. Do you understand? And God says, stop looking for solutions. Give it to me and trust that I have a better solution. I know tomorrow. You don't know tomorrow. The plans that you make may seem good to you, but if you knew tomorrow, your plans are a disaster. If you really want to be safe, trust me because I know tomorrow. If you knew the end from the beginning, you would follow me. Just surrender. Just learn to trust me. And we don't do that. We keep planning, we keep trying, we keep fighting, we keep struggling because we don't trust him. Why don't we trust him? Because we don't know him. Why don't we know him? Because we don't spend enough time with him. We spend time with him to solve problems or to do our duty. We don't spend time with him to know him. We go to prayer and say, help me, instead of going to prayer and stop asking. He knows your needs before you had a need. He knew your needs before you were born. He knew your days, all of it, before you were born. He knows the flowers. He knows the hair in your head, only for those that have hair. He knows you. Ellen White says, God doesn't need to be informed. What can you tell him that he doesn't know? If you hide in the bottom of the ocean, he can see you there. He knows your thoughts. The Bible says that God knows your thoughts from afar. But in Hebrew, the translation says, God knows your thoughts before they are formed. Before you think it, he knows what you are about to think. What can you tell him? Stop telling God. He needs to tell you. And so, before we learn to know him, we will never trust him. Therefore, when you go to prayer to present your need, your real need is not what you think that is your need. Your real problem is not what you talk about. That's what you think. You think that this is your problem. Your problem is that you don't know God. That's your real problem. Do you follow me? Your problem is not your problem. That's what you think. Your problem is that you don't know God. And so when you go to prayer, instead of trying to solve problems, say, Lord, please help me know you. Because to know God is eternal life. That's the reason we have no peace. That's the reason we struggle. Because we don't know him. If you know him, when you put your eyes on him and see how good he is, how patient he is, how wise he is, how powerful he is, you instantly get peace. When you don't have peace, it's because you don't know God. I mean, you sin today and you go and ask forgiveness. And then you sin tomorrow again and you ask forgiveness. And he forgives you again. And he knows that next day you are going to sin again. Yet he forgives you. What a patience. I don't have that patience. If it was for me to do the judgment, nobody would go to heaven. Yet God would take Mary to heaven, would take the thief on the cross to heaven, would take Rahab to heaven. Would you follow me? The woman at the well to heaven. They don't deserve it. Do you understand? We don't understand his love and his patience and his wisdom, and therefore we struggle. That's our real problem. And therefore, because we don't know him, we don't trust him. And we say we trust him and we love him. No, we don't. If we did, we would not struggle. We would give it to him and move on and whistle. I gave it to God. He's going to take care of it. And so, Jacob, when he was 60, he was a good Adventist. He ate tofu. He ate broccoli and green beans. He kept Sabbath, returned tithe, went to church, sang in the choir, and taught Sabbath school. Yet, all his life, he solved his problems. He would pray and then go ahead and do it himself. Instead of giving to God and do what the Bible says, wait upon the Lord. He would not wait because he didn't trust that God would solve it. When he was 60 and his brother came with 400 soldiers to kill him, and he had no option, then he finally surrendered. And when he surrendered, God solved his problem. That's what we need. So going back to the story, I had the car. I prayed, nothing happened. I went to my church and did a prayer seminar and told them, I said, before you fully surrender, you'll never be a Christian. You may be an Adventist, but not a Christian. And you need to be both. Do you follow me? And I said, you need to surrender everything, good and bad. You need to surrender your sins. You need to surrender your salvation. You need to surrender your health. You need to surrender your problems. You need to surrender your family. You need to surrender your car. When I said that, I said your job, your house, your car. When I said that, it came in my mind. Look who is talking. You have been struggling for 6 months to sell that car. Did you surrender? I said, oops. I finished the prayer seminar, got in the junk, and I was driving the junk back home. And I said, Lord, please help me sell the car. And God said into my mind, you need to live what you preach. I said, yes, I am. No, you are not. And I was arguing with God. And God said, you need to surrender the van. I said, take it. If it was Mercedes, probably I will keep it. But this is a junk. You can have it. And God said, okay, give it to me for free. I said, no. How much do you pay for it? And God said, you surrender. Give it to me. I said, Lord, I don't have money. I need money to buy a car, to drive to church, to visit people. So how much do you pay for it? And God said, you don't trust me, do you? I said, oh, yes, Lord, I trust you. Then give me the car. I said, how much do you pay for it? And God said to me, whatever you don't give up, you'll lose. Whatever you give up, you'll save. Give me the car. I had a hard time. Even a junk to let go. And so I said, Lord, give me the strength to give it up and fully let go and fully surrender and fully trust. And God said, do you really trust me that I am able to deal with your problem and that I love you and I will take care of you? I said, yes, I do. Then give it to me. And I realized that we say, I do, but we struggle. And I said, Lord, I want to believe. Help my unbelief. And God said, don't expect to believe. Just make a decision. Don't expect to feel faith. Oh, I feel good. Don't expect to have a feeling. Just make a decision. Say, okay, I give it to you. I said, okay, I give it to you. If you want to pay something great, more or less, if not, whatever. Who? That was hard, but I said it. I give it to you. You can have it. Guess what? When I said those words, I give it to you, instantly, I had peace in my heart. Until then, for 6 months, I struggled and prayed, please help me sell the van, please, and struggled and told my wife, it's a junk. This car keeps breaking. I paid $2,000 to fix it, and it's still broken. You know, right now, instantly, it's like I didn't have a car. I had peace. And I said, wow, it's good to feel good. Guess what? In that moment, my telephone started to ring. So I picked up the telephone. It was a lady from the church. And she says, Pastor, do you still have the van? I said, why? She says, I want to buy it. I said, no. I'm not going to sell you the van. If I sell it to you, you would hate me and never come back to church. It's a junk. It keeps breaking. I would rather sell it to a stranger. She said, it's the same thing. She says, I know it's a junk. My brother fixed it. Her brother was the mechanic who put the transmission. My brother fixed it for you. That's the reason I call you. Because a new van is 30,000. I am poor. I don't have 30,000. A second-hand van is 10,000. I don't have 10,000. All I have is 1,500. Nobody would give me a car for 1,500. And you asked 4,000 for it. That's what I was trying to sell it for. I asked 4,000. And she said, you asked 4,000. All I have is 1,500. Would you take 1,500? And I just told the Lord, whatever you decide, I will accept. So I said to her, okay, that hurt in my stomach. To sell it only for 1,500? I paid 3,000 for the car and 2,000 to fix it. I paid 5,000 and now I sell it for 1,500? I had pain in my stomach. But I said, okay, have it. She said, really? Thank you. And then she said, you know why I buy it? I said, no. She said, well, you preached that we should fully surrender and that we should make ourselves available to God, whatever He says, whatever the plans He may have. And God told me that I have to bring the poor to the church, people who don't have a car. And I don't have a van. I have a small car. So I need a van to transport people to church. But I don't have money. All I have is 1,500. So I gave it to God, the 1,500. And I said, if you want me to transport people to church, give me a van for 1,500. And she said, I was willing to sacrifice all I have. I said, take it. God bless you. You know what is funny? I called her 10 years later, and the van was still working. Because whenever you surrender, God works. And God gave me a Toyota Sienna. That's a good car. So God took care of her, and God took care of me. But I struggled before I surrendered. Only when I learned to give it up, then I got it. Do you follow me? That's what we need. That's the reason we struggle, because we never fully trust God to give it all to Him. Not only the bad stuff, but the good stuff. Our attempts to change ourselves, our attempts to change our spouse, our attempts to solve our problems, our attempts to be successful, to be good, to have a job, to have a school, you need to give it all to Him, not only with the words, but fully surrender, including your life, including your health. And if God says you need to die, okay, I die. If God says you need to move, like Abraham, okay, I move. You follow me? We make plans and we ask God to bless our plans instead of asking Him to reveal His plans, and we follow. And we wonder, why don't we get a blessing? Because we are selfish and self-centered. Even when you pray for your salvation, that's selfishness. You should pray for others' salvation, not for yours. God called you to save others, not to save self. He saves you, not you. Your business is to serve. That's our call, to save and to serve. But we serve self instead of serving God and serving others. And so, the greatest challenge, by the way, what time is it? 8:10. I do have a little time left over. The greatest challenge in the Christian life is not to keep Sabbath. That's easy. Lazy people keep every day. They never work. You don't sanctify Sabbath by not working. You sanctify Sabbath by encountering Jesus and surrendering and getting to know Him. You don't do your job studying the Bible. You do your job seeking Jesus in the Bible. You don't do your job praying. You do your job praying that you would fully surrender. Lord, I want you to take over my life, and I want you to do whatever I give you permission, and if I am stubborn, kill me. Do whatever it takes and make me follow you and serve you. That's Christianity. It's not when we struggle to accomplish something. It's when we fully give it to God. Not only the bad, but the good, everything. The reason we don't have power is because we don't surrender. We are self-focused. God cannot give you power to serve self. When you forget self and invest yourself into others, then God can give you power because you will use it properly. Do you understand? It's not safe for God to give you power before you fully surrender because you will not use it properly. When you fully surrender and He controls your life, then He can give you power. Jesus was smart, yet He says, I don't speak my own words. I speak the words that the Father gives me. He says, I don't do my plans. I do the works and the plans of the Father. Jesus depended on the Father 100%. Don't you think that He had a brain? He could talk. He could make plans. Yet He said, I don't make my plans. I follow the plans of the Father. That means to walk with God. Enoch walked with God. Abraham walked with God. Moses, Joseph, Daniel, Paul, all of them. That's Christianity, to learn to walk with God. To learn not to talk before He gives you the words. To learn not to walk before He gives you the direction. To learn not to act before He tells you to act. Every second to be fully dependent on God and fully surrender your life, surrender your school, surrender your job, surrender your health, surrender your family, surrender your stubbornness, surrender your pride, fully surrender and say, Lord, whatever you want, that's the reason I live for. When you do that, God is going to give you power more than you can handle, more than you can dream or pray for or imagine. We have small imagination. God is big. There is a quotation in 7 Testimonies, page 30, that says, to everyone, what does it mean, everyone? You. To every single one that fully surrenders, withholding nothing. Now listen carefully. Unlimited heavenly power is provided. How much? Unlimited heavenly power is provided for the accomplishment of measureless results. And then you go 2 pages later and she says, when we surrender, God can do anything through us. And then she says, whatever the disciples did, every church member should do today. Should be resurrections, should be healings, should be baptisms, should be power. But because you don't surrender, God cannot work. That's the reason you need to die in order to live. And you'll never have power and success before we learn this simple lesson. And you can try anything. Nothing is going to work except this one. How does it work? Very simple. You don't have the power to surrender. But when you put your eyes on Jesus, then you are going to have the power to surrender. The reason we struggle is because we keep our eyes on self, on others, on problems. Why do you struggle? Because you keep your eyes on problems. Why didn't Israel go into the promised land and they had to go back 40 years? Was it because there were big walls? Jericho had big walls? God could take down the walls. Was it because there was a big army and giants? God can take down the giants. It was because of unbelief, it says in Hebrew, because of their unbelief. They didn't fully trust that God would take care of it, and they tried to solve it in their power. And they died in the wilderness. You'll never succeed before you learn to fully trust. They put their eyes on giants. They put their eyes on problems. They put their eyes on big walls instead of putting their eyes on Christ. You will never know His power before you fix your eyes on Him. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. We say it, but we don't do it. We keep our eyes on problems. People come to me and say, I struggle. I keep sinning. And I say, how do you know that you sin? I know. That's because you keep your eyes on you. You monitor yourself. Oh, Pastor, I never grow. How do you know that you don't grow? That means you monitor yourself. You keep our eyes on you. Who told you to keep your eyes on you? Keep your eyes on Christ. When you put your eyes on Him and you see Him, you don't even think about you. You forget you. You don't know that you sin or you don't sin. You don't have time to think about you because you see Him and you say, wow. You forget that you are sick. You forget that you don't have a job. You forget that you have family problems. You forget that you are a sinner, that you cannot change. When you see Christ, all things disappear. Keep your eyes on Christ. That's how you surrender. That's how you know Him. That's how you trust Him. Ellen White says that we should fully look into His face, that we should fully contemplate Him and His character and His love and His sacrifice and His cross and His plans and His goodness and His... She says we should day and night meditate upon Christ and His character. We should meditate upon the last week of His life. We should always have our mind filled with Him. The more you think about Him, the more you know Him. The more you know Him, the more you understand Him and you love Him more. And the more you love Him, the more you want Him. And then you keep your eyes on Him more. And it never ends. And then you start to know Him and you start to trust Him. And when you trust Him, you don't have a problem to surrender. We don't surrender because we keep our eyes on the problems instead of keeping our eyes on Christ. That's the reason we struggle. And Satan wants you to keep your eyes on problems, because if he can get you discouraged and faithless, you are done. Without faith, it's impossible to please God, because faith is the channel that God can work, is the vehicle that God can work for you. If you don't have faith, God cannot work. How can you understand forgiveness? Can you explain justification? Can you explain how God can change your heart? Can you explain how He considers you righteous when you know you are a sinner? He says, when you confess, in that moment, you are righteous. And you know you are not righteous. How can you explain it? It's all by faith. If you don't have faith, nothing works. And to have faith, you need to keep your eyes on Him, because the more you know Him, the more faith you have in Him. Do you understand? That's how you surrender. And this, listen carefully now. This is not an event. This is a process. It doesn't happen. Poof! Oh, I have faith. I am righteous. This is a lifetime process. As children grow slow, transformation happens slow. And we have no patience. We want it now. Give it to me and give it to me now. We want to surrender right now. We want to have victory right now. We want to have power right now. And God says, slow down. Be patient. Growth takes time. You grow a little today, a little tomorrow. You cannot see the change from today to tomorrow, but 5 years down the road, if you look back, you can see that God has been working in your life every day. And we have no patience. God has patience with you. You don't have patience with you. Therefore, stop looking to you, stop looking to others, stop looking to problems. Keep your eyes on Him and trust that if you keep your eyes on Him, He will keep working on you. He is able, He loves you, He promised, He will finish what He started. None of your job to understand how. You need to have faith and trust that He will do it, regardless if you understand or not, if you deserve it or not, if you can do it or not. He will do it. Just keep your eyes on Him. That's the reason the Bible says, he who calls the name of the Lord shall be saved. But the Greek says different. It says, he who keeps calling on the name of the Lord. He who keeps calling continually. And it's not to say it, Lord, Lord. But the translation is to invite His presence continually. Lord, I'm nothing. Please come into my life. Lord, 5 minutes later, please come into my life tomorrow morning. Lord, please, I'm nothing. I cannot overcome. I cannot surrender. I cannot trust. Please, I need you. Come into my life. At noon, please come. In the evening, please come. Into my life, into my heart. Invite Him continually, because Christ in you, the hope of glory. Only His presence in you is the single hope we have. Period. Whatever else has zero power and zero results. Do you understand? My time is up. But somebody told me that if I don't finish at 8:30, I'm in trouble. She says, no, I didn't say that. So, folks, what we talked tonight, in my opinion, is the most important subject in the whole Bible. To know Christ, to fully trust in Him, to fully surrender, to always keep your eyes on Him. We are driving to Tennessee, and we drove through a tornado. We saw the tornado. The rain was extreme, so heavy that the car would go sideways. There were cars turned upside down. A different time, we drove through terrible snow. The snow was big, and there was strong wind pushing the cars. There were many cars in the ditch. One time, we drove in Montana down the mountain, and the brakes broke. And we drove down without brakes, and there were curves, you know? And one time when we drove to Tennessee, our friend, Mr. Ralph, asked my kids, you came through a tornado. Last time you came through the snow. Aren't you afraid? What do you do in the car? You pray, you scream, you cry. And my kids said, we play games. Aren't you afraid when you drive through tornado? And they said, no. And he said, why? We have been driving with Dad all our life. We know Him. If it was somebody else at the wheel, we'd be scared to death. But when He's at the wheel, we have seen Him driving. We are not afraid. And we know that He prays always and God's angels surround Him. We are not afraid. If the kids can say that, shouldn't we say, I know Him. I know He is at the wheel. Why would I be afraid? It's God. You understand? We don't know Him. And because we don't know Him, we doubt and struggle. So instead of trying to solve problems, rather pray and try to know Him. Because that's our real problem. I pray that God is going to impress you from now on to make that a priority. Lord, I want to know You. As a deer faints for the water, my soul faints for You. Please, I thirst for You. I hunger for You. Please, You may not give me the school. You may not give me the job. You may not give me the health. You may not give me the family. Whatever You take, I am okay. I trust that You love me and You do what is best. But this one, I don't give up. Help me know You. Help me love You. Help me desire you. Help me want you more than anything. Help me want you more than job. Want you more than life. Help me want you first. Do you understand? When you pray that way, the Bible says in Jeremiah 29:13, if you seek me with all your heart, I will let myself be found. In James chapter 5 says, if you draw near to God, he will draw near to you. When you pray that prayer, it's not going to happen overnight. It's a process. It's not an event. But the more you pray it, the closer he's going to get to you. And the more you pray, the closer he's going to get to you. And you are going to know him more and more. And you are going to start trusting him more and more. And he's going to work in your life and through you more and more. That's the focus, or should be the focus of our life. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much that you desire to have a relationship with us. What a miracle, the God of the universe, to want a relationship with simple sinner human beings. Sinful human beings. Please help us thirst for you. Help us desire you more than the other things, and pray for your presence and a knowledge of you more than we pray for the other things. Help us have a relationship with you. Help us know you and love you and trust you and have peace in you and surrender. We pray this in Jesus' precious name. And thank you, Lord. Amen.
In response to the message, I request everyone to stand and let's sing Take My Life and Let It Be, hymn number 211.